Marianne. Hi, Marianne.
Hi, Dawn. Hey. Good to see you.
Where did she go?
Where'd she go?
Hi, Gail.
Hey, Miss Millen. Hey, Gail. Randy.
Hey, John. Hi, Gail.
Hi, Gail.
Hi, Gail.
Good morning.
Peace and protection.
And now suddenly,
hi, Mary.
Hi, Heather.
Hey, Guillermo.
Yeah, that's
right. Guillermo.
Guillermo.
Thank you for saying it.
Oh,
hello.
Hi, Guillermo.
Hello.
Guillermo is here. Hi, Guillermo.
Hi, Guillermo.
Hi.
Is my Bible there?
Where are you, Guillermo?
Able to find Miss Rebecca.
I am in my car.
You're living in your car now?
Ooh, good morning. Hi,
Good morning, Mark.
Good morning, Margaret. Hi, Steve.
Good morning, Duran.
Good morning, Julie.
Hey, Duran. Fans, it's good to see you.
Yeah.
Hi, everybody.
Oh, big dog. Big dog.
Big dog.
Oh, my God.
Hey, Rusty.
Morning.
Mariana, hi.
Hi, Betty. Good to see you.
Margie.
Hi, Margie.
Hi, McMillan.
Hi,
good morning.
Yeah, good morning.
Hi, Marty.
Good morning, Cyril.
Good morning, Cyril.
Good
morning, Bill.
Marty.
How are you?
Good morning.
Hi, Carol.
Hey, McGinnis. McGinnis is a little bit humid in St. Louis.
Let's see your grandchildren.
No, it's really nice.
Really nice. Good.
Look, he's got on his UPC shirt. Way to go, Larry.
I had a friend who would summer here rather than.
Well, for some reason, Mom, I could never get. I can never get your home style vanilla ice cream.
Nice echo going on.
Hi, Isabel.
Hi, Steve.
Rusty.
Hey. Von Seal, how hot today in Dallas?
Oh, it's going to be around 100.
Oh,
and the humidity will be there.
All right. Good morning, UPC. Welcome to worship. We're so glad that you've joined us this morning. We're so glad you've joined us for worship this morning. Just a few quick reminders. We are streaming on YouTube, so hello to the YouTube folk out there. But if you don't want to be seen or heard on Zoom, make sure you hit that mute button or that stop video button, and that will make sure that you're not seen or heard. Behind me, we are in another one of our worship spaces this morning. This actually comes from Patty Lane. This is from a gully behind her house. It's a path that she walks as part of her worship. So thank you, Patty Lane, for sharing your worship space with us. And just a reminder, if you would like to send in a picture of your worship space and have us all join in that space together, please do send that over to me over in email. And now our liturgist is Mary Beth, and I'm going to ask her to unmute.
Good morning, and a warm welcome to all of you worshiping with us on Zoom or YouTube this morning. I'm especially gratified to see a whole lot of people worshiping with us today. I hope you all are somewhere cool at home during these dog days of summer. I'm really excited about the service today, so just you wait and see. I have several announcements to pass on. Remember, every Wednesday, you will receive an email from UPC with all access information for Zoom services on Wednesday evening and Sunday morning that week. Also, there are other announcements, links to devotionals, and information about various study groups in that email. We'll be having our very first Zoom Vacation Bible School, July 20th through 24th, which is just around the corner. Information about packet pickup will be provided this week, so keep your eyes open. And let you know right now, if you have children that will participate, registration can be completed on the UPC website this week. If you have a specific prayer request you would like me to include in the prayers of the people, please use the Zoom chat feature and send it to me during the announcements. That would be right now, or during the passing of the peace. Any requests sent later than this cannot be included in today's prayers, but will be included in our prayer chain. On Saturday, July 18th, I will be leading a team to cook dinner for the Opportunity Center for the Homeless. We will meet at UPC and use the kitchen to cook while we're wearing masks. Please let me know if you can help cook this Saturday. The time commitment is from about 2:30 to 4:30. Right now, we have a special video to share.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. You know. There we go. I'm good to go. It says I'm muted. I'm unmuted. Thank you. You know, there's a lot of accomplishments that Maureen has had when you outlast the hallelujah chorus with the credits, right? But I think that's why we want everybody on Zoom right now. Maureen is on with us somewhere out there in Zoom land. So we're going to unmute everybody. If everybody can just start applauding and give your best cheer and your shout out of appreciation to Maureen. So the celebration will not end with this. We are going to immediately after worship, we are going to have a parade by Maureen's house. Now, we sent you an email at 5:29 Thursday morning that had directions. If you missed that, it is 8:41 Gomez. They're not expecting us till noon, so nobody show up before then, it won't do any good. So if you would like to hop in your car, go out, honk, be crazy, tell Maureen how much you love her, go on out. If you think that's a little bit too much of a challenge, stay on to the, we're not going to do fellowship groups today, but you can stay on the live feed. Tim is going to have from his car, he's going to Zoom the journey. Now it's going to take a while. It's not going to be continuous, but if you want to see and kind of keep it on and bird's eye view of what's going on, you can do that as well. We'll announce this at the end of the service. Now, we are going to, and I also want to thank, oh gosh, you wouldn't believe how many hours of dedication from how many people, Marty Anderson and Steve Ailey, and Steve Haddad and Bill McMillan and Jenny and Tim, the list goes on. We love Maureen. We have special, special music to begin our worship service. Let us worship God. Thank you.
say God is glorified, and adoration leaves no room for pride. It is as though the whole creation cried, Alleluia.
Please join me in the call to worship. The words will show up on your screen. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing and give praise to God's name. Tell the glad news of salvation from day to day. Let us worship God.
We gather this morning to sing and to pray for one another, to encourage and just be with one another. But we also gather as a people who need to be honest, to be truthful. And that honesty and that truth leads us to the realization that we in and of ourselves are not enough. That we have come together to recognize and confess our need for God and friends. Let us pray that confession together now. Please pray with me using the words found up on your screen. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone, have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me. You desire truth in the inward being, therefore teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have crushed rejoice. And now, friends, let us go to God in silent prayer. Amen. Continuing to use the words from Psalm chapter 51. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. And the people responded using the words on the screen, saying,
Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit.
Amen. Friends, may the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
And now take a moment, go ahead and click that gallery view or say hi in the chat box, and let us pass the peace with one another.
Peace, everybody.
Hello, Wimmers. Peace be with you.
Hello.
Peace.
Hey, Lisa.
Peace
be with you, John.
Peace be with you.
As we prepare to hear God's word in sermon, scripture, and song, we first go to God in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, send your spirit that our eyes, our ears, our minds, and our hearts might be opened, that we might hear and be changed by your word this day. Amen. Our vigil reading this morning comes from Jeremiah chapter 31, starting with verse 31 through 34. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to one another, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more.
Because I said thy love is better.
Let anyone with ears listen. Are you listening? To hear God's word is not a one-time occurrence. It's an ongoing characteristic of discipleship. Listening is essential to discipleship. In a moment, I'm going to read the gospel lesson from the Gospel according to Matthew. It's a parable. But when I ask yourself, what am I hearing as I listen? Where do I find myself in this parable? When and where have I felt these various responses that Jesus is talking about to God's word? Why? What am I experiencing now as I listen? From the 13th chapter of the Gospel according to Matthew. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. And such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground where they didn't have much soil. They sprang up quickly, but since they had no depth of soil, when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some a hundredfold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. That is what's sown on the path. As for what was sown on the rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word, immediately receives it with joy, yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among the thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on the good soil, this is the one who hears the word, understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. A couple of weeks ago, I shared with you stories of faith, about how our faith has often been communicated by telling stories. And today is very similar. Today's lesson from the gospel, Jesus tells a story. And it's a story that people understand because it was a primarily agricultural community, and so he's giving an agricultural story. And it's interesting that this story is even familiar today. Many people may not know it's from the Bible or it's from the Gospel of Matthew, but the sower and the seeds is a little more common story. The story begins with a crowd, and it's interesting that the crowd is so large that the only way that Jesus can address the people is to get into a boat, go out a little ways, because it was so crowded. He had to get away so he could talk to everybody. And that got me wondering, would there ever be today such a crowd so desperate to hear the word that it would cause somebody to take extraordinary measures so they could address them all. The crowds are still quite common, even in today's COVID-challenged world. There are crowds at political rallies. There are crowds at protests. But people are hungry, I think, much like the crowd that listened to Jesus, much like the crowds today. People are hungering for a word of hope, a word of direction. So Jesus tells this story about a sower whose job is to throw seed, and he's throwing seed everywhere. We know that God is the sower, and God just tossing out seed. Some of it goes over there and there. Some goes on rocky ground. Some goes on the path. Some goes on bad soil. Some goes on good soil. But the point is this is an abundant sower. God is throwing seed everywhere and doesn't seem to care that some falls this way or it's fate. The sower just does what the sower does, and that's to throw seed and to cast it far and wide. As the sower, God is constantly trying to add to the kingdom intake. God's grace abounds everywhere. The word has come. The word has been sown and now is awaiting response. Jesus tells the story, then Jesus explains it. And from his explanation, we could get some very basic points. Jesus emphasized you must understand the word. I think for me, that's pretty obvious. It's called Christian education. More than a 15-minute sermon and scripture lesson on a worship service Sunday morning. Christian education, whether in a large group or lecture, small groups, enables us to dig into the soil, and to understand. Taking root depends. Those with thin or no roots, those who are curious but no commitment, those who are committed, but then distracted. Those who are committed and invest themselves in discipleship, which is why I prefer the word discipleship as opposed to membership. The rich soil is where the word convicts and grows and grows. There are many instances at UPC about such conviction and rich soil, but because we're celebrating Maureen today and the Feed My Sheep ministry that she's so much a part of, that's one very good example of the word convicting and producing as we feed and care for the least. So the parable and its explanation is pretty easy, right? Well, as Rick Morley, the author, says, the uncomfortable reality is that I have good soil potential within me, but it's only a stone's throw from some very rocky ground, and not far from thorns or weeds either. All of those are within me, and depending on the day or the moment or the circumstance, depends on what kind of soil is going to be there. Other thing we have to wrestle with is in today's political charged world, often we just want to hear what we want to hear. For some, the word is CNBC. And for others, the word is Fox. What does understanding God's word mean? I spoke recently with a woman who finally did what she always wanted to do. She said, I want to read the Bible cover to cover. I want to read it for myself. I want to see for myself what the Bible has to say. Jill Duffield, our editor of Presbyterian Outlook, says, understanding, though, is not simply intellectual assent or theoretical knowledge. It is perceiving clearly. It is comprehending. It is spiritually intelligent. That's the kind of understanding that the prophet Jeremiah spoke of when he said that God's word would be written on the heart of God's people. Jesus is asking us, yes, to bring our brain, but also to bring our heart so that his word can take root within us. This isn't something that happens by chance. It's not because we're fortunate to have good genes. It's something that we put effort into. And yet, good soil, as all you gardeners out there know, comes from manure and compost and scraps and bugs and worms, and it stinks a lot of times. But that's what produces good crops. Again, Jill Duffield says, Jesus is reminding his listeners that evil is real. Persisting in the faith is hard. The temptation to cave into the values of the world, unyielding. Having ears to hear and a heart to take root is the key to enriching the soil and bearing fruit. Don't forget that in such a challenging and strange and different time, God's still tirelessly throwing seeds, and they're springing up here and there, some places where we may expect, some places where we may not expect. And that continual sowing, the continued abounding of grace, is what gives us hope. We need to keep asking, where is it that God's word is flourishing? Bearing fruit means living out the kingdom of heaven. This isn't just piety or syrupy pronouncements or vague decisions. It is, as the early church said, following on the way. Following on the way, imitating Jesus and doing what he did. When Jesus, as our model of what the kingdom of heaven looks like, bearing fruit then means equality. It means opening our doors and open table fellowship. It means embracing the human dignity of everyone. It means resisting oppression and resisting religious corruption and caring for the least and the lost. Bearing fruit is lived out in the messy, everyday life. And when we live it, then the word of God is an experience. Because after all, the word of God did become flesh and lived among us and lives among us today. Amen.
Let us quiet our busy minds and pray. Lord, on any given day, we come to you with many things on our minds and hearts. Sad things, scary health things, financial things, personal relationship things. Today we arrive with the same concerns on our hearts and minds, but we are also aware of the beauty and good in our world and our fellow humans that comes from your love. We struggle to make sense of tragic events beyond our control. Fires, floods, hurricanes, wars, accidents, and disease, which belong to all of us, even if we are not directly affected by them. They belong to us because we care about people and justice and the future of our country and our planet. Let us question why other humans similar to us would find inside themselves fear, desperation, and justification enough to harm others they perceive as a threat, but who are not directly threatening them. Instead of meeting their hatred and anger and fear with those of our own, let us be open to finding ways to end such perceptions that create senseless violations of trust. Help us find ways to address violence and hatred with love, taking on the pain of others so we might better understand, and seeking forgiveness where we have been thoughtless or ignorant, acknowledging those faults in ourselves. We cannot change until we can see the thing that needs changing, and often it is us, our perceptions or patterns of thinking that are too narrow to include the experiences of others. In our own lives, let us be open to more love of all kinds in all our interactions with others, at work, at church, with those of different beliefs, other skin colors, other sexual identities, socially, politically, and within our families. Let us remember we are all children of God, despite our religious, political, and cultural differences. We are meant to live together on this earth, finding ways to cooperate across lines of geography and wealth. Help us chip away at the imbalance of power between people, political parties, and nations where we can, modeling the love Jesus taught. Give us the courage and energy to share and listen to the pain and experiences of others, even if we are uncomfortable, so that when we finally get it, we can rejoice in the connection based on understanding and acceptance. We pray diligently for peace, for the families of all those who have been separated from those they love through war, famine, sickness, and immigration. We pray for our military members working to keep all of us safe, and especially for Danny Anderson, who is now in Afghanistan. We pray for our political leaders at all levels of government, asking that their own fears will be calmed by trust in you. Help them seek wisdom and reconciliation over absolute power and financial gain. We pray especially for those who see the possibility of positive change in the world, who fight an uphill battle making it happen. Give them and us the courage to continue the work and believe in it. As our entire world copes with the pandemic of COVID-19, we pray for health workers everywhere, for families and individuals fighting to get well. In particular, Pastors Holly and Casey at Grace Presbyterian in El Paso, and many other staff and clergy throughout our presbytery, for Maureen's niece Lisa and her husband. We earnestly pray for the whole El Paso region, which is currently experiencing a surge in coronavirus cases. We earnestly pray for a vaccine to be developed quickly and safely. We rejoice with Pat Radcliffe and Steve Schiller at his son, who is doing much better. Even with this, we all pray for the strength to continue to live as richly as we can during this time of upheaval, trusting you to get us through. We pray for Amanda Ozer's mom, Kate Patton, who is waiting on aorta repair surgery, for Patty Lane's good friend, Renee, in hospice care, for Callie Weston's daughter, Sarah, now going through stronger chemo, for Esther Martinez's brother-in-law, Nacho Estrada, suffering from pneumonia, diabetes, and end-stage cancer, for Joan Ugarette's friend, Michelle Tenen, whose 17-year-old daughter, Charlie, passed away suddenly, for Steve Vine's sister, Kathy, who has been placed in a long-term care facility for serious health issues, for former member Nancy Mosier Nelson's sister, Patty, and brother-in-law, John, as John is in hospice care with end-stage cancer, for Sharon Ridenour, Ruth Daniels' friend who fell and broke her hip. If we forget to be so at times, we are ever grateful for the blessings in our lives, from simply being alive to all we have, food, shelter, clothing, wealth, and relative safety, meaningful work, and the leisure time to enjoy being alive and sharing that time with those we love. We are especially thankful for the safe return of the McNabb family to Fort Bragg, North Carolina. Keep close in our minds and hearts that we live with your love always. We pray for courage and perseverance to do what we can to counter the evil we see around us. We now join our voices in the prayer your son Jesus taught us to pray, which comforts us in our struggles to deal with our lives and the issues in the world. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We continue to thank you for your offerings. It helps to enable ministry, ministry that is desperately needed in these challenging times. As usual, we'll put up on the screen the various ways you can give by mail, by online, or by talking to Jimmy about arranging with your bank. Please give as we, as this family of faith, continues to do ministry in our community.
Share of our abundance with those who have real needs that cannot be met without it. We are grateful and we are humbled by your generosity. Direct our small gifts to do meaningful work in this world. Amen.
We're going to invite you to do a couple of things. Either hop in your car. That should be a route rider. Maybe wait a couple of minutes. Remember, they're not expecting us till noon. So 841 Gomez. If you don't have Google, look at your email that we sent out Thursday morning. Remember, if you can't, if you don't feel up to traveling out to Maureen's, hang on here onto the Zoom. You don't have to do anything. Tim will take you on a Zoom tour. Now that's going to take a bit, so it's not instantaneous. If you can keep on and you can look through Tim's eyes, so to speak, at the parade, and that'll give you a view. So friends, may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of God's Holy Spirit be with us all now and forever. Amen.